Personal experience, it's important. and thank you very much for doing that. And we're here to worship the Lord. We've already worshiped Him some with our opening song and with your hearts being ready to receive God's word. Thank you so much for being here. God is going to bless us this morning.
Amen.
All those prayers. About all I've done is pray the past 2 weeks. Father, thank you for bringing us together. Let us be a church. Let us be under your hand. And let us love one another. We are here because of your Son. It's the only reason we are here. And it's a good reason. Father, I pray for each person here that their heart might be right as they leave. That the things that you have allowed in our lives but really do not want them to be there, the fears, the troubles, will all melt away during this service as we concentrate on you and the God of all solutions. God, we love you with all our hearts. And we praise you in the blessed name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Let's continue to sing. Would you stand with me again?
Lord, how majestic is your name in all.
His triumph song I'll ever sing.
someone who is undependable. You are not someone who decided to leave us to our own devices and our own sinful ways. But you are holy. Because you are holy, sin cannot enter your presence. Because of our sin, we could not enter your presence. But you chose. You chose to send your Son, Jesus Christ, to pay the penalty that we could not pay, to make things right for us between you and us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you that you did that for us, that you sent your one and only Son to die for us on that cross and rise again on the third day.
Well, I do want to welcome those of you that are guests. And I do want to explain to you that I don't normally sound this way. If you've never heard me before, usually I sound like a scared little girl. But I have had COVID we were diagnosed, Chris and I, on December 30th. So have no fears, I'm not contagious. I'm just messed up. And I am glad to be back from the dead, and that's truly what it feels like, having survived COVID. There was a rumor going out that Chris and I had very mild cases. That is not true. It was very severe. We were very sick for 14 days, and we're still recovering. Now, as you know, COVID hits people differently. Let me impinge for a minute. You don't have to answer this. But if you have had COVID, would you raise your hand, please? Okay. If you know someone who has had COVID besides me, would you raise your hand, please? Okay. If you know someone who has died from COVID, would you raise your hand, please? So we see how very real this is and how dangerous it is. And I appreciate you taking precautions out of love for other people. COVID hits everybody differently. My son-in-law got it. My two grandkids got it. My daughter got it. My grandkids and son-in-law showed no symptoms. He tore the house down. They're remodeling their house, and he's got video of him tearing down walls and with COVID. My grandkids are trying to help, too. But a good friend of mine died just days before I was diagnosed. So we tested positive. Everyone experiences it differently. We had a very bad case, and we're still trying to recover. I don't see Chris has made it, so I guess she was not able to get here today. That's my wife. I know some of you wonder what it's like to get COVID, and I am going to tell you what it was like for me to get COVID. It was like someone had taken a pump and put it in my head and filled my head full of fluid. That was the first thing. As far as it could go. And they said, let's give you another 10%. And they did. And then it just began to drain, and I began to lose my voice and choke and things like that. But that wasn't the worst thing. The worst thing was that that was not so bad for about 3 days. We binged watched The Mandalorian. I thought, this is a piece of cake. And then it wasn't a piece of cake anymore. It was like someone had stripped off all my skin and taken pincers, clothespins, and attached them to every inch of the muscles in my body and squeezed them. And then that would go away, and the headache would come back. And that would go away, and then chills would come. And that would go away, and then fever would come. And that would go away, and I just shook, and I couldn't even control myself. I still can't hardly hold a pencil. So no artwork going on in my house right now. And then there's the fatigue, where you're just so tired, so tired. On the worst night, Chris checked my temperature, and I was running 103.5 and unresponsive. And so she called an ambulance, and inside me I kept saying, don't call an ambulance. But I couldn't say, don't call an ambulance. And so they came in, and they said, well, unless you're gasping for breath and ready to die, we can't take you in, because there's no hospital bed within 200 miles of Texarkana. So you might survive. And so they brought in the stretcher, and of course they couldn't use the stretcher because they couldn't take me. And then I stumbled out of bed the next day, and I noticed that our manger scene was overturned, and I thought, well. And immediately I stopped in front of the manger, and I said, Dear Father, don't let baby Jesus' hands be broken. And then I just cracked up. I thought, what kind of ridiculous thing is that to say? God the Father can take care of baby Jesus' hands. And so I'm looking at the manger scene. I'm going, Jesus is okay. Mary's good. Joseph's laying on his side. Isn't that just like Joseph? Isn't that how we treat Joseph? Poor Joseph. On his side, neglected. So I picked him back up again. COVID is a killer. So protect yourself and others by wearing a mask. But COVID, in a sense, was a blessing to me. Because what else can you do when you can't see to read and you're laying in bed and you can't get out of bed? But think. And it's 2 o'clock in the morning, you say, I need to get some sleep. And you just start thinking about spiritual things. Can't read the Bible, but I know the Bible. And so I'm thinking and I'm praying. And many, many thoughts came to my mind. Some in deeper ways than I've ever thought before. And I'm not going to share them all with you. But I will share 3 things with you. 3 things that God taught me on a deeper level. It was a personal restart. So I'm going to approach this message from the perspective of the series that I began before I got sick, which is God's Restarts, what COVID taught me. Genesis chapter 1 and verse 28. Taught me, as I reflected on it, to embrace the change. We're in the Garden of Eden in chapter 1. God blessed them and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. See if I can make it over here. I've always known that tricks are for kids. 2 favorite cereals, Cocoa Puffs and Trix. Because I'm so mature. I kind of like Cocoa Puffs a little more because you get free chocolate milk. But I kind of like Trix because they're so fruity. But like everybody, there's a sense in which I resist change. I kind of like things to be the same, though I'd like them to be different, but I like some constants in my life. And so a few years ago, when they decided to make fruity shapes and tricks, I rebelled. Those of you that are old enough to know tricks as just round balls that are colored and fruity flavored understand what I'm talking about. And so they changed them into fruity shapes, and you could buy them mixed fruity shapes and balls, or you could buy them just the balls, or you could buy them just with the fruity shapes. Well, I'm not having any fruity shapes, okay? I just want the traditional Trix balls. One of the things about COVID that happened to me was my senses changed. My vision became very acute at one point, where I could look into the bowl of the Trix and I could see the little pores in the little fruity shapes. And everything was really super bright. Now, some things I had no taste for. Couldn't taste. Some things tasted like dirt. You ever eat dirt? I have. I've eaten dirt. You dig a hole and you're going to eat dirt. So some things taste like, but sweet things were like, ugh, I'm dying, they're so sweet. And so I'm eating the tricks. And I'm thinking, man, I wish these were little balls. And then I'm thinking, what kind of a moron are you? What is wrong with fruity shapes? They're pretty. They taste good. There's nothing wrong with this at all. And so since I couldn't do anything else, I very slowly ate the tricks and thought about the fruity shapes and the sweetness. And I realized every time I've eaten tricks in the last 5 years, I have unnecessarily stressed myself out over a stupid shape. And what's wrong with the change? God told Adam in verse 28, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, and subdue it. What this meant is that Adam went out one day and he dug up a stone and he heated that stone and out of it came liquid. And through generations, that liquid, that iron, was turned into steel. And that steel was turned into a building. And in subduing the earth, that building housed a corporation. That corporation developed a product. And now every 2 or 3 months, that corporation gives us a new ISO. And we go, oh, different icons. Oh, things are in a different place on my phone. Oh, this is horrible. Why can't we have it back when we had flying toasters? Do you remember the flying toaster screensavers on the Macintosh back in the 80s? But it's change, and it's improvement, and it's frustrating to learn new things. But do you really want to sit around a campfire and eat out of a clay pot? Or do you want us to continue to obey God's command, which is to subdue the earth and embrace the change? Because change means growth. I have a very vague memory of my mother saying to me once when I was about 9 or 10, your legs are hurting because you're undergoing growing pains. Do y'all remember growing pains? Any of you guys having growing pains right now? It's horrible. And it's because your bones are growing so fast that all this activity is going on in your bones and it just hurts. But I'm glad I'm not 2 foot tall anymore or 3. But the growth pain, the physical growth pain, is necessary for me to grow physically.
And I hadn't thought about that in years until I was working on this message, and I thought, that was painful, but that memory's practically gone. And the positive is still with me. Emotional growth hurts too, you know. The fears that we have to face and the failures from the past are painful, difficult. But do you really want to face life as a three-year-old? No, we don't. We want emotional maturity. And when you conquer something in your life that is an emotional difficulty, you feel good about it for the rest of your life. So it's worth the pain. Spiritual growth also hurts. Stay awake at night wondering, what is God's will for my life? Wondering about that difficult passage that seems to contradict the rest of the Bible. The unanswered questions, why did they have to die? Why did I have to get sick? Why can't I live in a bigger house? Where is God in my trouble? But don't you want everything God wants for you? Do we want to sit around the tree at Christmas and not open the presents? No, I want them all. I want everything God wants for me. Because growth makes me stronger. Growth makes you more useful. And on a purely selfish level, spiritual growth makes you happier. Because you're at war with one less person in this world. And that, of course, would be God. So COVID taught me that change can be good. But COVID also taught me to release your anger. Ephesians 4 and verse 26. Ephesians 4, 26. Be angry and do not sin. Now, if you've come to church today with anger, guess what? You are absolutely normal. If you wake up tomorrow and you're angry, you are absolutely a human being. Human beings are the best human beings to hang around with. So I'm glad that you're angry. Because anger is a positive emotion. Anger results from your desire for justice. And who is the most just creature in all the universe? It is God. The Bible says that God is angry with sin every day. Did you know that? Is that a bad thing? It's who God is. And we have been made in the image and likeness of God. And so to be angry is a normal, healthy thing. It is anger that prepares you to defend yourself from attack. You know, the old psychiatric thing, fight or flight, is a real thing. Anger prepares you to protect yourself or to run away when you cannot protect yourself. Anger is normal. However, here's the caution. Revenge is harmful. No one profits from revenge because revenge keeps your focus on the slight, on the attacker, and takes your mind off of everything else. You know, you can only think of one thing at a time. And if you think about how someone has hurt you, that's all you can think about. Now, all of us, of course, think about how people have hurt us. But some people think about it for a long, long time. Weeks and months and years. And slowly, they are destroying themselves by maintaining these evil, vengeful thoughts. And it's so unnecessary. It may be somebody that hurts you in school. And you've been out of school 40 years. It may have been someone that you were once married to, and you're not married to them anymore. Why relive it? It's a kind of a mixed thing, this desire for vengeance, this desire for revenge, because there is this desire for justice, which is good, but this desire for someone to pay, which is bad. And that makes revenge very selfish, because ultimately, when a person is fueled by revenge, they want to extract more from that person than that person took from them, the pound of flesh, the Merchant of Venice. And people get all excited because they begin to profit from another person's sin. You harmed me, I'll sue you, I'll have extra money, I'm better off for having been harmed by you. This is not the right attitude. This is the attitude that turns us into people that are not godly. So one thing that I was pondering during the COVID thing was to hand off your anger. I was preaching at a church one day, a long time ago. I've preached since a long time ago, but this lady called me up and she said, Brother Adams, I want to apologize to you for what I said. And I said, well, what did you say? And she told me, and I thought, I have no idea what you're talking about, lady. I have no idea what you're talking about. But I try to be gracious. I said, it's okay, don't worry about it. Some people are obsessed with trying to fix every little problem in their life. And if they think that they offended somebody by calling the color of their tie wrong, they'll apologize. Please don't fall into that trap. It's unnecessary. And please don't try to fix everything that attacks you, because you don't need to. Do you know that? Just before I got COVID, somebody flipped me off in their car. This time I did nothing wrong. I was driving the speed limit. I was letting everybody she just flipped me off, and I thought, well, that's pretty rude. But it happens all the time. I thought, well, I could think about this, or I could just go on. So I just went on. Who cares? I'm not going to flip her back off. I'm not going to try and run into her. I'm not going to try and cause her trouble. What do I care? It's just a stinking finger. Okay, 1 out of 10. Things like this, you can let them go. Who cares? Somebody calls your name on social media. Who cares? You realize the idiocy that goes on in social media. Expect it. Just let it go. You don't have to call them up and chew them out. You don't have to fix this. Just let it go. And of course, there are other issues that are a little bit bigger. And there's ways to deal with these larger issues. You could talk to someone and say, hey, I was kind of put out by what you said. Am I misunderstanding this? Or you can talk to a trusted friend or a counselor. You do not always have to confront someone who has attacked you. It's not necessary. But sometimes you cannot let it go. And in these cases, God tells us to surrender our vengeance to another person. Romans chapter 13. If you'll turn there for a minute. Because you cannot solve all of your attacks. But God gives us resources to go when we can't do it ourselves. So Romans chapter 13 says this in verse 3. Verse 3. For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to evil. Implicit in this verse is that there are several levels of authority that we can go to when our grievances are not solved, when we can't let go of our vengeance, our revenge. Children can go to their parents. What a blessing it is to go to your parents. Please do not neglect your parents. Even if you're older, go to your parents. Students can go to their teachers. I know you don't believe this, guys, but your teachers mostly love you. And they spend many hours praying for you, working for you, wishing for your success. You got a problem? Go to your teacher. Ultimately, well, not ultimately, but also, we can go to the government authorities. Verse 3, rulers are not a terror to good works, but to evil. Now, of course, this is a general principle. Adolf Hitler was a terror to good works. But by and large, throughout history, the government is on your side. Now, this was a very difficult couple of weeks for me, not just because I had COVID, but also because I had a lot of time to be passively interested in the events that were going on in our nation's capital. And as I'm curled up in a COVID ball, checking the internet on the invasion of our nation's capital by a bunch of thugs, who, by the way, mostly were wearing masks, I discovered that they had a gallows erected and were intending to hang the vice president. And that people had posted on social media that they were going to kill Nancy Pelosi. Desecrating our national monuments. Causing our legislation to go into fear and hiding. It's like a movie, only it was real. And I wondered, what is wrong with these people? Do I hate them? No, I do not hate them. Do I pity them? Yes, I do pity them. Because what's driving these people is fear. Fear and anger. Anger that their world has gone out of control and they can't do anything about it. So much so that they felt that they had to try and take over the country. Against all odds, what are the chances? None. They're all being hunted down and arrested now. And life is going to be much more miserable for them now than it was before. Why could they not see that they needed to hand their anger off to someone else? To each other. To the government. We have ways to deal with this, you know. To God. And yet they did not. And it just means that they'll suffer more. And we too. As we worry about what's going to happen between now and Inauguration Day. Let's pray for a second, okay? Oh God. Never before has our country faced such difficulties as this. We have militia protecting every of the 50 capitals. We have people that are afraid of a civil war. But God, we know that the vast majority of Americans not only are looking to you, but also our resolve to follow the rule of law in this great democracy that you have given us as a great gift. Never before in the history of the world have you given anybody this, but you've given it to us. God, help us, each one here, to be a positive influence in this, to pray, to love our neighbors, to love our country, and to love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we can't always fix our anger. When authorities can't resolve our anger, God gives us another place to go. Romans 12 and verse 19. Beloved, do not avenge yourself, but rather give place to wrath, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay. You see, God will ultimately save you from your anger. It might take a long time, might take a lifetime. You know, God did not vindicate Jesus till after he was crucified, after he was scourged, after he was rejected. And he's not been ultimately vindicated yet. But Paul wrote that in the end, every knee will bow. Every voice will say that Jesus is Lord. And someday, your anger will be vindicated. In the interim, you may have to suffer. In the interim, don't take vengeance. It will only increase your pain because it makes you a bigger target for your enemy and removes you from God's help. COVID is a killer. The pain of COVID was so unbearable that three distinct times I wished I had died. And God said, you will not die. He specifically said, you will not die. And I said, well, thanks a lot for that one, God. And I did not die. I may die of something else eventually, but I'm not going to die of COVID. The fatigue was debilitating. I would get up from my chair and get a glass of water and have to rest for 20 minutes. Now, I'm not looking for sympathy. I'm looking to warn you. Don't get this. Don't give this. But if you do get it, maybe God will give you some insight into some spiritual things. Please take advantage of that. Because COVID taught me that you can and you should love your church. Hebrews chapter 10, please, and verse 24. Hebrews 10 and verse 24. The third thing that COVID has taught me in a deeper way. Let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works. Love cares. Did you know that? Love cares. Many people, many of you told me you cared about me and Chris. You phoned us. You texted us. You sent us cards. And you always said, I don't want to keep you for a long time because I know you're not doing very well. And you were right. But even in expressing your love, you expressed your love on a deeper level. And I want you to understand, if you can, what a great source of strength that was to us. Every time someone texted, every card we got, I broke down and cried at your thoughtfulness and love, knowing that that many of you also are undergoing difficult things, or had just recently come out of them, or are going to go into them, as some in our congregation are missing today because they are in this right now. Many of you showed us that you cared. You brought in meals. You picked up groceries for us. You got our medicine when we couldn't get it. A neighbor took my trash out to the curb, COVID trash, because I couldn't get out there. Got my mail. And probably every one of you prayed. Now, you know how many prayers it takes to get God's hand to move? You know how many times you need to eat a day? Once. I usually eat a couple times a day, sometimes three times a day. The more prayers, the better. The more meals, the better. When two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst, Jesus said. Prayer changes things. Today's headline was, we're pushing 400,000 dead in the United States of America over COVID. Hundreds of thousands of people have had this. I don't mean to be flippant, but in some cases, death was a good thing. The pain was so bad for some of these people. How many more would be sick? How many more would die if it were not for the prayers of God's people? How much worse would it have been for us if you hadn't prayed for us? Please understand, a 30-second prayer can mean everything in the life of a fellow believer. We were spared death. We were spared worse. We were spared hospital stay, which even though we wanted to go, would not have probably been a good thing. We'd have been a hallway somewhere. But it is God's church. It is Central Baptist Church that deserves credit for the positive of COVID in our life. Because the church heals. COVID is more than a physical illness. I sat somehow with some position one night thinking, I don't even want to go on. I just want to die. And I'm reviewing my life and I'm thinking, well, every goal I've met for myself except retiring, I have met. What more is there to do? I guess I could die. It wouldn't hurt anything. And it's because of the nature of the illness that it affected my mind, too. Because it's more than a physical thing. And I'm thinking about school, which I have not been back to school since before Christmas break, so I got students not working probably. Papers to be graded, lesson plans to rearrange, a big mess. And I was able to do some things at home, but I'm thinking, oh, I'm looking at the television and there's dust on it. And you know how I hate dirt. And I'm thinking, I'm looking at the floor and I'm thinking George Harrison's song, While My Guitar Gently Weeps, I look at the floor and I notice it needs sweeping. I'm thinking, yeah, about 50 times a day I'm thinking that. And I can't pick up the broom to clean it up. And I'm just thinking, why? And I'm thinking, oh my goodness, I just heard about this church member that's got it, this church member that's sick, this church member that's got to have an operation. I can't even call them because I cannot speak. And if they don't get a text, they don't know I care. But You texted me. You called me. And you brought me out of the miry clay and made me realize that someone loves me. And I love someone. And after every contact, I was stronger. Church, people, is so much more important than we think. It is a great place to come and worship the Lord. In fact, this morning, holy, 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 my favorite hymn of all time. And I couldn't sing it, but I could listen to you sing it. And I could worship with you together. Church is so important. It's the only place where you can worship God in that way. But it's more than that. It's sitting in Sunday morning Bible study, which we've all missed, but now we're back to it. And razzing each other and joking and getting spiritual insights from each other over the discussion, over the scripture. And eventually eating donuts again. And it's you bringing me meals and me sending you meals. But do you know what church is? Really? Besides all these things? When Jesus was on earth, he put his hands on people and prayed for them. Some he healed, some he did not. He put his arm around people and said, I love you. God loves you. He enlisted people and said, listen, I got something for you to do. I got an important place for you to work in the kingdom of God. And he showed them how to do it. One of Paul's favorite phrases about the church is that it is the body of Christ. As Jesus lives within every Christian, and the Christians get together and participate in church, it is Jesus Christ walking and working among us. That is what the church is. And I know that there, in any given church, there are people on the peripheral and there are people right smack dab in the middle. What COVID taught me about the church, Central Church, is that this is okay. This is the ultimate. So if you're thinking, well, I go to church every once in a while, that's fine. You're welcome to come whenever you can come. But I want more than the edge of life. I want to be in the center, and I hope you do too. If you'll stand, please. We're going to have an invitation. It will be in the pew. I will be somewhere around here. You can talk to me later on if you need to. God's still saving people. He'll be glad to save you if you will ask him to save you. He will see you through whatever trouble you have today if you will ask him to see you through. But he and the members of Central Baptist Church love you with all their heart. Let's pray. Father God, how good to be able to address you both ways, as Father and as God. And to thank you this morning that Jesus is Lord and sovereign, and nothing happens to us that you are not aware of and concerned about. Father, I pray for those in our congregation who today are home sick with this terrible thing. I pray for those that might get it. But Father, I pray that mostly through all these things, you will help us to love you more and to love each other more and to understand the great gift that you have given us through Jesus Christ, your Son, our brother. Amen.
Without